Praise the Lord. We warmly welcome you to Davar, the Word of Promise program. Today, we wish to take you through the liturgy of the Word meant for the second Sunday of Advent. And today, we are honored and privileged to have Professor Anton Meemaner to guide us through the liturgy of the Word. We welcome you, Professor. God bless you.
God bless you.
Yes, Professor. So, today also, as we begin our discussion, I invite you to give us a general theme or a summary based on the liturgy of the Word.
The second Sunday of during the Advent season is very crucial for this reason, because even our modern world is a bit like what is reflected in these readings, especially in the first reading. We are also facing a lot of crisis, lot of messy situation, hardships, and also confusion, and also disappointment and frustrations. So the readings today, actually all the readings, give us deep hope as how to struggle during a crisis period. So we could say the virtue of hope, how we are going to cultivate it, how we are going to develop the virtue of hope in God is reflected in and through these writings. So therefore, I think, you know, even for the modern world, and the contemporary situation, we could get a lot of spiritual nourishment from these readings.
Thank you very much for that beautiful summary of the liturgy of the Word, Professor. So my dear brothers and sisters, so we can take the theme as hope through the entire mass readings for today. So in order to get a better understanding, I think it's time for us to go to the first reading. The first reading is taken from Baruch chapter 5, verse 1 to 9. Jerusalem, take off your robe of mourning and misery. Put on the splendor of glory from God forever, wrapped in the cloak of justice from God. Bear on your head the mitre that displays the glory of the eternal name. For God will show all the earth your splendor. You will be named by God forever. The peace of justice, the glory of God's worship. Up Jerusalem, stand upon the heights. Look to the east and see your children, gathered from the east and the west. At the word of the Holy One, rejoicing that they are remembered by God. Led away on foot by their enemies, they left you, but God will bring them back to you, borne aloft in glory as on royal thrones. For God has commanded that every lofty mountain be made low, and that the age-old depths and gorges will be filled to the level ground, that Israel may advance secure in the glory of God. The forests and every fragrant kind of tree have overshadowed Israel at God's command. For God is leading Israel in joy by the light of His glory, with His mercy and justice for company. Yes, Professor. So when we take this first reading taken from the book of Baruch, which is a deuterocanonical book, could you first and foremost introduce the author, his experience and the background as we start the discussion?
Traditionally, there is a long tradition about it. Baruch was considered as the personal secretary to this great prophet Jeremiah. In fact, there is another letter written by letter of Jeremiah, most likely penned by Baruch. And in this book, actually, one of the most difficult experiences of the Israelites is reflected. In the whole book, if you read the whole book, the background is, you know, they had this one of the toughest experiences in their history, which is the Babylonian exile, which happened in 586 BC, or according to some historian, 587 before Christ. And they suffered, Jewish people suffered tremendously. They underwent untold sufferings. Actually, if you compare the other nations with Jewish nation, no nation on earth has suffered like the Jewish nation. So that's why we can learn a lot from their history, not because they are Jewish people, no, but because of what they had undergone. Actually, their colonization started even before any Asian country or African nation was colonized. Like Sri Lanka, if you take the Portuguese came to Sri Lanka in 1505. But the Jewish people became slaves under pharaohs roughly, let's say, 3,500 years ago or 600 years ago. So they had been suffering from that long, over 3,500 years. Therefore, they are the most qualified to talk about also hope in God, because there is a reality, the greater the danger in life as well as in our communities, the greater the danger, the greater the possibility for rescue or salvation. In other words, the more we suffer, the more we can experience the salvation that comes from God. So the book of Baruch is a fantastic work, actually one of my favorite books in the Bible. So therefore, the author in this chapter 5, 1 to 9, after reflecting about the whole experience, he came to the realization, if you read chapter 3, 4, we are also responsible for our miseries. He did not blame the Babylonians alone. He felt because of our sinfulness, because of the sins of our fathers, our previous generations, they did not trust in God. They trusted in politics or in the superpowers like Assyrians, the Babylonians, the Egyptians. And that's why Baruch is saying we are also responsible for this mess. Don't blame this and this one, that one. We should also take responsibilities. And in this chapter, the one you just read, it's a chapter about deep hope in God. Now, this is not a kind of a historical, something that happened 2,600 or 550 years ago. This is an experiential reality. Experiential reality means they understood, they experienced, and also they realize the only hope out of this situation is to rely on God more and more and more. Now, those who have such experiences, they know the strength they get from such an experience. So collectively as well as individually, this is absolutely true. Because God is real, God is true, God is very much active and living and dynamic. God is not a kind of an imaginary entity, imaginary concept. Therefore, when we rely on God, what will happen to us? We become alive. We become energetic. And hope in God gives us a lot of energy to go to face any situation. A lot of life, and also we become new, not only inwardly, but also outwardly. That's why at the very beginning, Baruch is hinting, Jerusalem, take off your robe or garment of mourning and misery. That means when we hope in God, not only inwardly we become new, but also outwardly it radiates. Our outward manifestation or appearance also becomes a new appearance. It changes. So we are no longer the same person or the same people, both inwardly as well as outwardly. So it's not a kind of a mental attitude. You could see a renewed person, a person who lives in hope, even outwardly, that person is no longer the same person. Lot of, let's say, energy is radiated in and through that person. So that was the experience of the Jewish people. We could also undergo the same experience, especially in our contemporary, absolutely messy world we live in. We need Baruch more than ever, this experience.
Yes, Professor. So, as you said, interestingly, the Prophet is encouraging the exiles about their return and their restoration of land. At the same time, as you said, the Prophet is encouraging them to put on a new dressing. He says, take off the robe of mourning and misery and instead put on the cloak of God's justice. And at the same time, at the end, we hear he is asking them to put on the garment of righteousness, peace and godly glory, which is so vital. So if you could extract something from that aspect and share with our viewers about this hope the Prophet is giving them.
Yeah, because you see, hope also makes us a new person. We become a new man and a new woman and a new creature. We are no longer the same person. So that is the nature of hope. It renews us deep within. It purifies us. Our interiority or our soul will be purified by hope. So that's why actually hope is very different from pessimism or optimism. Most of the time in the modern world, we talk about optimism. Optimism is, problem with optimism, in a way it's not bad, but optimism is something we could control, something we could somehow manipulate and manage. Hope comes from God actually. It's not from any human person or human agency. It comes from God. Therefore, there is no disappointment in hope. There is no frustration in hope. Because God is never going to disappoint us. So we should be able to distinguish between the worldly optimism, optimism because of technology or because of the political and socio-economic system, etc. They are good, you know, we need them. But hope is something much more deeper and much more radical than that. So what we need is true hope, as Prophet Baruch articulated it, and also to undergo the same experience. Meaning to say, actually there is no reason for, in other words, no reason for us to become hopeless or to give in to despair. In fact, in the traditional Catholic teaching, despair or hopelessness is considered as one of the sins against the Holy Spirit. When we give in to hopelessness or despair, that means we have given up hoping in God. We have kind of distanced ourselves from God. So that is not an option. So under all difficult situation, we could truly hope, we could start a new life actually, in other words, simply put, a new existence as individuals as well as a nation. Here is emphasis of course on Israelites as a people, but it's also a reality individually in each one of us.
Yes, Professor. So as you say, we need to focus on the goodness of God so that we will be uplifted in hope and in this virtue especially. So with that, let's move to the responsorial psalm for today, which is psalm number 126, verse 1 to 2, 2 to 3, 4 to 5 and 6. The Lord has done great things for us. We are filled with joy. When the Lord brought back the captives of Zion, we were like men dreaming. Then our mouth was filled with laughter and our tongue with rejoicing. The Lord has done great things for us. We are filled with joy. Then they said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us. We are glad indeed. The Lord has done great things for us. We are filled with joy. Restore our fortunes, O Lord, like the torrents in the southern desert. Those who sow in tears shall reap rejoicing. The Lord has done great things for us. We are filled with joy. although they go forth weeping, carry the seed to be sown, they shall come back rejoicing, carrying their sheaves. The Lord has done great things for us. We are filled with joy. So, Professor, we see that this Psalm number 126 is a song of joyful thanksgiving for restoring a community from hardship and exiles. So, could you elaborate on this?
Yeah, actually, this is also a very good psalm and a very good experience, because when we really rely on God, we become greater, we become bigger as persons as well as a nation. Meaning to say, we begin to believe in our potential more and more and more. Sometimes, you know, we are very negative about ourselves, we could be. Also, we have sometimes a very low estimate of ourselves. So what God gives us here in this, according to this psalm, is He is making us big, greater, gigantic. Then we feel actually we had not done justice to our own selves. And also God usually brings the best out of ourselves. That's also one thing he does. Then you see your potentials you did not see before, you did not notice earlier. So He makes us gigantic. He does not make us smaller in order to feel good about Himself. You know, that's what we do usually, right? Usually we put someone down and we crush him and then we feel good about ourselves. God's way is very different. He wants us to become bigger, greater, and spiritually much more gigantic, spiritually stronger. So that was their experience, especially this is after the exile. This is about restoration of the fortunes of the whole nation and return from the Babylonian exile. But it's not a simply a return. You went to a foreign country, now you are returning. It's not like that. You are returning as a renewed nation. If it is the same nation that is returning, you know, what is the big deal about it? You are no better than before now. The difference is you were in a foreign country, now you are back. It's not like that. It's much bigger than that. God has made them spiritually enlarged, spiritually magnanimous, so that they don't have to repeat experiences like that. That's also there. So, meaning to say, if they really lived with this experience, with this hope, there will not be another exile. No need to be exiled. But of course, the thing is, human nature is as it is. Sometimes they tend to forget. In fact, Israelites forget and got into more troubles. It's not the fault of God. It's their own fault. They created that situation. You see, we are responsible for our own destinies. We are by and large create our own fates through wrong decisions. Yes. So that's also one thing we can learn. We could also learn from all the blunders made by the Jewish people, the Israelites. So what is the lesson? We should not repeat those blunders individually as well as collectively.
Yes, Professor. So there's something that I have, you know, gathered throughout the years. If an individual or a nation unite or join God, they always become the majority, because God is greater than everything. So with that, I have another question to raise from the same psalm. So this psalm also essentially conveys a message that even when we are in tears, God can turn all that, our sorrow, our misery, into joy. If you could talk on that.
In fact, Jesus also talks about the same thing in one of the Beatitudes, right? Happy are those who mourn, you will be comforted. You see, it's also in the passive voice in the Greek text also. That means it's not, true consolation comes from God. True consolation in life comes from faith in God. It's not we are trying to console ourselves, because you see, for true consolation, we have to rely on someone, something, or somebody bigger than us, greater than us. As children, we relied on our parents, teachers, elders, right? As adults now, of course, we can't do the same thing, but we have the parent, the father. So true consolation ultimately comes from God and God alone. So that's the realized experience of the Jewish people. That's the truth about life. If not, you see, if there is no saving God, life is a hopeless thing. Life is what you call a useless passion, a useless enterprise. But life is not, because God is. God exists. He is true and real. He is living. And no matter what, He is not going to abandon us. He will never leave us, even when we feel absolutely miserable, absolutely down and hopeless, pessimistic. That's where you can experience God all the more, actually, deeply. Yes. When we don't have any human consolation, when we don't have anything to rely on, that is where His saving power begins to work.
Yes, Professor, there's another, very crucial question that I need to raise here. It's this phrase, those who sow in tears shall reap rejoicing. If you could elaborate on this factor as well for us.
Those who sow in tears shall reap rejoicing. Yes, so provided, there is a underlying theological idea that you should not be responsible for the miseries of another person. Sometimes we suffer unjustly. This is such an experience. That means we have not done, against anybody, a great damage or an injustice. And yet, because of the sins of other people or our forefathers, our parents or parents' parents, we have to face a lot of difficulties in life. We call it the sufferings of a righteous person. Then, of course, God will recognize it and then will be very sympathetic to this person. Christ was a person like that, and early martyrs and some of the great saints down through the centuries. So that's why if we suffer, we have to suffer without committing any injustice or without damaging another person. So in other words, it's better to get hurt than hurt someone. It's in fact, Jesus' way was, it's better to get, attacked or beaten up than beating someone or inflicting pain on another person or harming another person. So that's the suffering of a righteous person. Suffering of a just person, it could be an individual or a whole nation. Even if you take for an example, of course, the Jewish leaders during this time made a lot of blunders, but Babylon was, during that time, was the most powerful nation on earth. In fact, Babylonia was able to defeat Assyrians also. They became the superpower in the Mediterranean basin. And they inflicted a lot of injustices, a lot of great damages to other nations. So the Israelites were no match militarily to either to Assyrians or to Babylonians. So naturally God could see the situation. So naturally God would sympathize with this tiny little nation, the Jewish nation. But it doesn't necessarily mean everything Jewish people did was right. No, they also committed a lot of sinful deeds, anti-God activities, but they came to a sense of repentance. Yes. So that's why it mentioned about that aspect also. They realize, yes, we are responsible. We committed these blunders. We forgot our God. We forgot the covenant and the Torah. So repentant, when we repent, that's a good thing. Right? In fact, a repented sinner is no longer a sinner. You have deeply and authentically repented. So God will recognize it. And God will do justice to such a group of people.
Yes, Professor, as you say, when we repent, that conviction, that change of heart is recognized by God. So that brings a lot of consolation and hope to any nation, any individual. So with that, let's move to the second reading for today, which is taken from Philippians chapter 1, verse 4 to 6, 8 to 11. Brothers and sisters, I pray always with joy in my every prayer for all of you, because of your partnership for the gospel, from the first day until now. I am confident of this, that the one who began a good work in you will continue to complete it until the day of Christ Jesus. God is my witness. How I long for all of you with the affection of Christ Jesus. And this is my prayer, that your love may increase evermore and more in knowledge and every kind of perception, to discern what is of value, so that you may be pure and blameless for the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ, for the glory and praise of God. Yes, Professor.
You see, during the Advent season, we have four Sundays. Usually we reflect upon two central theological truths during this time. So this reading talks about one of them, that is the second coming of Christ. Actually, during Lent, two, I said, theological truths: the second coming, which is going to happen in the future, and the first coming, which happened about 2,000 years ago in Bethlehem. So this is about the day of Christ Jesus, or day of Jesus, is referring to his second coming, the parousia. Actually, that concept had been also largely influenced by an Old Testament concept, which is called Yom Yahweh, day of the Lord. They thought the God Yahweh, God, is going to come and do justice and defeat all his enemies, etc. So those connotations are clearly there in this reading. So it gives, actually, the second coming gives us a panoramic perspective about the whole thing. Let's assume Jesus came 2,000 years ago. He became one of us through the mystery of incarnation, God becoming human and taking flesh. After that, he taught us the way and how to live and how to serve one another. And then he died. He was risen from the dead. That's it. That was the end of it. Then it's an incomplete story, incomplete journey. So he has to come back in order to do justice to us, in order to evaluate whether we have been living according to his teachings. It's like this, actually. Like, let's say we teach a class, group of children, we teach everything about that subject, let's say mathematics, and now they are quite competent. But after that, the teacher has to give an examination to the students. And then not only that, after that, if everything ends with the examination, it's incomplete. The teacher has to give them marks. The teacher has to grade them, their capacity, their weaknesses, their level, whether they have to improve more about the subject matter, etc. So therefore, in order to complete what Christ started, he has to return, he has to come back. You know, that is also that coming, second coming, also an event of tremendous joy as well as tremendous hope. And we don't have to be afraid of it, actually. Most people would like to know the exact date of his second coming, because if they have the idea, if we give them the idea, no, maybe another 1,000 years it will take. Of course, then they think they could still sin more. Anyway, he's going to be delayed. We can sin more and continue what we had been doing. Anyway, he's not coming very soon. You see, that's a very dangerous trap. We should not be concerned about the exact date and the time and the minute. Each day we must live as if he is going to come today. let's say this morning or tomorrow morning or next day, as if he is going to come. We should live each moment meaningfully. Therefore, the exact date should not concern us. It's an unnecessary preoccupation, like some Christians are very much preoccupied with that. It's a waste of time and waste of precious life. We must get on with the business of living our day-to-day life meaningfully, as if Christ is going to come at this moment. So when we live like that, you have done justice to your life. Not only that, when you look back at your life, you have lived a full life, a complete life, a life that is pleasing to God. So therefore, his exact date or time should not be a great concern for us. So he is reminding St. Paul, and also he's talking about this great joy actually in it. This festive joy in the act of waiting for the day of Christ. You see, hope always gives us joy, but not optimism. The optimism I mentioned, because in optimism we become anxious because things may not go according to our plan, the way we plan. But in hope you don't become anxious. You become very calm and very steady and very settled. And also you get rid of this desire to control events. Optimism is different. Technological optimism or political optimism or economic optimism is a different kind of animal, so to speak. But not hope in God. In hope, even things don't go the way you had already planned, you don't get unnecessarily anxious, because you know God is in charge. Now, in order to accept God is in charge, you have to become a bigger personality. If we have a small personality, we can't accept it. We want to control. If you let go of things and if you let God be God, that means you have become spiritually great, magnanimous, vast and gigantic. So no need to control, and also in the process you become so free, like St. Paul was so free. Actually, he's writing also his experience as a Christian, as a disciple of Christ. This was also his experience. So he is communicating it with us, sharing it with us, so that we could also realize what he realized. We could experience what he experienced.
Yes, Professor, as you say, we need to prepare, we need to be ready, but we must not be anxious about the day of the Lord. Just take it as by the day. So with that, it's time for us to go to the Gospel for today.
The Gospel reading according to Saint Luke. In the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, when Pontius Pilate was governor of Judea, and Herod was tetrarch of Galilee, and his brother Philip, tetrarch of the region of Iturea and Trachonitis, and Lysanias was tetrarch of Abilene, during the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, the son of Zechariah, in the desert. John went throughout the whole region of the Jordan, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins, as it is written in the book of the words of the prophet Isaiah. A voice of one crying out in the desert, "Prepare the way of the Lord, make straight his paths. Every valley shall be filled, and every mountain and hill shall be made low. The winding roads shall be made straight, and the rough ways made smooth, and all flesh shall see the salvation of God.
Yes, Professor. So, when we take this gospel narrative into consideration, taken from Luke chapter 3, verse 1 to 6, here you mentioned seven names, names of leaders taken from the secular world and the religious. But to none of them came the word of God. Interestingly, the word of God comes to John, the son of Zechariah, in the desert, not in the temple of Jerusalem or any other place, but in the desert, in the wilderness. If you could touch that aspect and just reason out why the word of God came to John here, not to these leaders mentioned.
In fact, they were not ordinary politicians or political leaders. Tiberius Caesar was the Roman emperor. After Augustus Caesar, he became the second emperor and the most powerful person on earth, politically and militarily, a bit like, let's say, today, the president of the United States of America. And also Pontius Pilate was one of his agents. He was the governor of Judea, southern Israel, very powerful man in that region. And also Herod the Great, actually, here. We are talking about the Herod the Great, the father of Herod, the other Herods, like all the other, he had ten children, actually. One of the children was Herod Antipas, the one who killed John the Baptist. And Herod was also very powerful in the northern region, upper region. And Philip, also his brother, Iturea and Trachonis, today that region belonged to Jordan area. And Lysanias was at Abilene, the Syrian area. So all the big political leaders, military leaders, they are the most powerful people during that time. And also the leaders of the religious establishment. Actually, the high priest was Caiaphas. His father-in-law was the Annas, but Annas was very powerful. He still ruled in and through his son-in-law. Now, as you mentioned, God's word went to none of them, meaning to say God was not, in other words, God was not interested in them, actually. Because they were also not interested in God, you know. Who would care about God when you have the most powerful military on earth? The Roman army was the greatest, the infantry in the world, right? Who cares about God? And also these priests, Annas and Caiaphas, collaborated with the Roman governors and the Roman emperor for their, you see, benefits. They were also, in a way, politicians, actually. So they wanted to keep the priesthood, the high priesthood. Therefore, they collaborated. They did what the Roman governor and the Roman emperor wanted them to do, naturally. Right? They were in a deal. Now you have this John the Baptist who was dressed up like a beggar, actually. Right? Hardly anything he ate. Right, looks like a very kind of a vagabond, you know, like a fugitive. But God was interested in this man who was preaching in the desert. There is another aspect to that, very important. That is, you see, John the Baptist was someone like in the Old Testament, if you remember the great prophet Elijah. Elijah also, for his food, there was this raven, crow, who brought meat, bread, etc. for Elijah. Meaning to say, they did not depend on the dominant social, political, economic system. So John the Baptist did not have to worry about his salary increase, his perks, his benefits, pension, Christmas bonus, etc. because they were so free from the dominant socio-economic system. Therefore, he could speak the truth even to kings without any fear of losing any privilege. Elijah was like that. In fact, he spoke bravely against the King Ahaz when he committed a lot of injustices, when he killed people. John the Baptist was also like that. Because then you are so free, you don't have to cut deals with the dominant power structures or the politicians. Then you could truly serve God. You exist, you live only for God. As long as you please God, you are not afraid of anybody else. In fact, as we know later, Herod Antipas was so scared of him, John the Baptist, because he spoke the truth. Even though he hated John the Baptist, on the other hand, he was scared of him because he had true spiritual authority or spiritual credibility that comes from God. That is not depend upon any political, military, economic connection solely through God. He was an instrument of God, absolutely and totally. So no wonder God was with John the Baptist. And also one thing you mentioned, you made allusion to, with the coming of John the Baptist, actually, the theological center now has shifted. It was the, until then, the center of worship, and those who want to go have an idea about God has to go to Jerusalem. Mm-hmm. Jerusalem temple and all the high priest and the chief priests, etc. But now the theological center had undergone a radical shift. So people are abandoning Jerusalem. In fact, if you read the chapter 1 of Mark, it becomes very clear. They left Mark as well as Matthew, Matthew chapter 3, my memory serves very well, chapter 2. They had abandoned Jerusalem, going to the desert. You see, actually, people should be going to the Jerusalem temple because the priests are there, all the rituals are being done there, all the ancient traditions. But now, they are abandoning Jerusalem, going to the desert, meeting this a person who looks like a beggar, you see, who does not have any majestic clothes or anything. Can you see how radical it is? Yeah. So what was his message? A baptism of repentance and forgiveness of sins. Yeah. And John the Baptist spoke with such great authority. In fact, you have heard of this famous historian, Jewish historian Josephus Flavius, in his Antiquities of Jewish People or the History of Jewish People, he writes actually about John the Baptist. He says he was a great preacher, orator. When he spoke, the effect was like electrifying, you know. It's like a fever, actually. Not because he knew how to speak or he had a training in all these nice words, no. His authority was so powerful, people were affected tremendously. He had more followers, actually, historically. More followers than Jesus. The reason is, he started earlier. Yes. Jesus came late, right? Later. So he had more followers and also a greater group of people around him when Jesus started. That's why Jesus also went to John the Baptist. Jesus recognized the genuine spiritual authority of John the Baptist. So that's why he is a very important figure for us Christian also. So we have a great devotion and respect. In fact, aside from Jesus and Blessed Virgin Mary, we celebrate his birthday as well as his day of martyrdom, both. Yes. Only three people we give that honor. Nativity as well as the last day of their lives. So John the Baptist starts with another very important thing, quotation from a prophet, Isaiah. Great prophet, Isaiah chapter 40 actually. This was also about right after the Babylonian exile. This one was in, you could read it in the Isaiah chapter 40. Right after the Babylonian exile, it say, quotation about hope. A new world that is going to be dawn. Yeah. All flesh, mean all humanity, shall see the salvation of God. So the world is going to change. The values we have in this world, our world, values will be turned upside down. It is going to be a new world, new scale of values, according to, not according to our own selfish agendas, but according to God's agenda. So all his life, John the Baptist committed himself for the service of God. Total commitment, actually. Absolute and total commitment. That means he had this single-mindedness, which we should also develop as disciples of Christ. So he had only one agenda in life, that is to please God. So that's why he was not afraid of anyone else.
Yes.
So when you have that attitude, you become so courageous. You develop a lot of stamina, spiritual stamina and strength. You are not afraid of anyone.
Yes, Professor. So when we take this gospel narrative and when we apply it to today's context, we see that the word of the Lord will come to us in times of isolation, maybe frustration, pain, and helplessness. So if our viewers, if our nation, or if any individual is going through such a period, we need to offer a prayer to God. Taking all this into consideration, let us offer a prayer together so that everything that we discussed will really enlighten and enrich their lives. Let's offer a prayer.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We thank you, Lord, for all the guidance and the strength you had given us to face any crisis in life, any hardship, any difficulty, any frustration, any disappointment, any loss, and also blunders, miscalculations sometimes we may make. In and through all these failures, let us become humble enough to rely on your strength and on your wisdom and on your guidance. And also give us the realization that it is God alone, and only God and God alone is our ultimate hope and ultimate goal in our life. We ask this all through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Yes, Professor, we heartily thank you for coming here, joining us, and enlightening us. God bless you.
God bless you.
Yes, my dear brothers and sisters, we hope today's program really enhanced your spiritual journey. So we wish to wind up, and we hope to see you next week with another enriching program like this. So until we meet you next week, stay safe and God bless you.